Hi, John. Nice to meet you.
You too.
Now, I just like to know that you have been involved in that with the IPL and you have been a part of it. And the impact of the IPL and the Indian cricket in general, and how it has changed the overall of international cricket. What are your thoughts on it?
Well, when it began in 2008, was the first IPL, so it's nearly 10 years now, isn't it, since its inception. So what it's really, two sides. There's an off-field side and an on-field side. Off-field side is that it's certainly popularised the game. It's a format that obviously spectators, fans love, short form. Plenty of action, sponsors, TV broadcasters are all becoming very interested in that short form of the game. So it's certainly changed, I think, the way that cricket is consumed off the field. On field, very much the same. Batters, fielders, bowlers these days have now developed repertoires that prior to that time weren't really seen. Batters have invented new shots, they take more risk. The bowlers, on the other hand, and I think one of the interesting things is that I believe there's a bit of a gap between batting technique and bowling these days, because batters basically now prepare far more than what bowlers do. Bowlers don't have the opportunity, or don't take the opportunity to spend enough time perfecting some of the skills that are required for the game, whereas batters will train, have a net, then they'll grab the coach, get the coach to throw them, and then they'll jump on a bowling machine and keep hitting. So their game is, I think, developed far more than what the bowlers have done. Bowlers just don't put in the same amount of time. So we're seeing new shots, we're seeing new types of deliveries, we're seeing some exciting fielding. I think we're seeing some interesting selection changes too. To say, for instance, the specialist wicketkeeper has been almost replaced these days by a batsman who keeps. Not sure that's the right way to go, but that's how the game's changed. So on field, that type of game now has affected the way that one day cricket's played, and obviously that flows into the long form test cricket as well. So certainly impacted the game, no question.
Yeah. Then, what about now? Now, when you were the coach of Australia, you all beat India, in Australia and India. But coming back 10 years later, now, Australia, I feel that Australians can't compete in the subcontinent.
Yeah, yeah.
Any reasons that you can see?
Oh yes, look, I think it's not just one-way traffic though. So in other words, I think there would be a lot of teams that come to India or Sri Lanka or Bangladesh and find it hard to play. So the likes of England, South Africa, Australia, New Zealand, less so the West Indies, because their wickets have become even more like Indian wickets and Sri Lankan wickets than they are here. So conversely, when India and Sri Lanka and Bangladesh and everybody come to Australia or to those other countries, I think they struggle as well. I really do think the central point of the performance gap is that teams no longer spend sufficient time in the country, wherever they're travelling to, playing before they actually play the main games. So most itineraries these days are quite compressed, quite short, such that there's very little games leading into a test series or leading into a one-day series. There are virtually no games between tests or one-days. And so really that gives a visiting team, as I said, little opportunity to acclimatise, weather-wise, but acclimatise to the skills that they need, or the skills that they have, which need then to be adapted to the current conditions.
Yeah, but at the same time, a lot of Australian cricketers are
they're playing
familiar with
they're playing in the IPL conditions. Yeah, yeah, but I, yeah. again, I think, as we were saying before, I think the IPL is a different format of the game. It's a short format. And so I think we've just seen in the recent T20 games between Australia and India, finally balance. There's not too much difference between the sides. However, when you extend that into longer forms of the game, then it's a different game altogether. So you need that ability to adapt your skills as the game gets longer. Wickets conditions change, and therefore, Indian conditions, Sri Lankan conditions, spin plays a significant role, obviously, and over the course of the game, it has a greater impact on the outcome of the game. Just as if India came to Australia, and over a long period of time, the wicket and the bounce plays a longer, or has a longer impact on the way the game progresses. So I just think it's all due to the fact that players are not spending sufficient time in the country that they travel to adjust their skills to prepare them for the test match of the one day cricket.
Yeah, but now talking about you, now you changed the face of Australian cricket. The impact that you made is still talked about. Actually, how did it happen? That period with Pronti Manu.
Yeah. Look, I started in 1999 with Steve Waugh as captain, and then Ricky Ponting took over in the one day side in 2002 and then took full control from 2003. And then I finished at World Cup 2007. So it was about 8 years, and in that time we won across all formats, all games, all countries, around about 75% of our games. So it was a very good period of time. So we have very good players, no question. You know, and to achieve the results that we did couldn't have been done without the quality and the depth of the players that we had. But to say that it's as simple as putting a whole group of good players together and then you're going to get those results, I think belies the fact that there's a lot of other things that go into making our success, and of which one of those is obviously coaching and leadership, which we were previously just talking about, and how you harness all those resources together, and how you challenge all those resources so that they're constantly looking to improve themselves individually or collectively as a team. And really, in the end, that was the role. That's what I've been speaking about here in Sri Lanka yesterday. At our conferences and workshop, the CEO Forum, our leadership summit, one of the principal roles of a coach is just to do that, to create a learning environment where individuals are constantly challenged, whether it was a Shane Warne or a Glenn Lorrain or a Ricky Ponting or a Matthew Hayden or Adam Gilchrist, Brett Lee, whoever it might be. It was always about trying to challenge them to be better than what they currently were, no matter how good they were, and making sure that the players respond to that, making sure that we can consistently measure performance other than results. So whether we're getting lots of wins, series wins and so on, which is ultimately the result, but what was contributed to that result, how can we improve technically, physically, mentally, tactically, each person and as I said as a team to get better and better all the time. That was the role we had.
Yeah, but in that forum, you had players like Simon Sowers.
Yes, of course, and that's I think one of the beauties of I was talking about peak performance teams, which the Australian team was over that period of time, and you need all sorts of people. You know, you need different types of people, different types of characters, and of course, you know, not everything's going to run smoothly. You know, individuals are just not going to fit or step out of line at different times, and again, that's not only the role of the coach and the leader to deal with that, but the reason for success of a team is that it self-regulates. So whether you're the captain, whether you're the coach, whether you're the vice-captain, or whether you're just a player, it's about, well, what standards are we prepared to accept, what are we prepared to tolerate, and everybody has a role in delivering that.
Yeah, that in your last World Cup effort against Sri Lanka, that was against the final was against Sri Lanka, and the final itself was a little controversial.
It was
the line and a swash ball. And how do you see it as the coach?
That's what it was, 10 years ago now.
Yeah.
I certainly remember it for Adam Gilchrist's innings that really set that final line. It gave us a real opportunity to put ourselves in a position to win the game. But then, of course, Jayasuriya and Sangakkara and Jay Wardner, had other thoughts in mind. And that made a reasonably tense game, but I thought we got ourselves in a position to have won the game. And then, of course, the light umpire's decisions all made that sort of a little bit, definitely a bit murky towards the end. But look, we played exceptionally well right through that. Probably one of the things that's not really recognised is that in 2003 we went through the tournament undefeated, had a very close game against Sri Lanka in Port Elizabeth, but we went through that tournament undefeated, and then we did exactly the same in 2007. So that was about 22 or 23 World Cup games, including two finals, that we were unbeaten. I think that's an amazing effort for any team in any sport to achieve that. And the final then was really just, in a sense, a culmination of how we played right through that 2007 World Cup.
Now, scenario of cricket is changing. Now there is a move to have 4-day cricket.
Mm.
And the people, the daylight cricket is already in.
Yeah.
And at that time, during your time, it was not there.
Yeah.
So how do you think that is going to impact the future of cricket as a whole?
Yeah, no, I think it's a good question, and I think while I'm a person that's very much about innovation and looking at change and so on, I'm at the same stage a person who tries to respect tradition, what's important to the game in cricket, or if I'm in a business, what's important to the business, what are the traditions, what are the anchor points that you need to establish so that new people coming in understand what, in this case, the game is all about and the history. So to me, Test cricket should never move away from 5 days. It should never move away from white ball, red ball, white clothes, white sunscreen. That's traditional. 5-day Test cricket, that's the format. That should stay because it's been around for 130 years. So we shouldn't basically cast that to one side, albeit there have been changes over time, rules and regulations and cover wickets and all those sort of things, but fundamentally it's been the same through the whole history. Now we've got pink ball, which I believe is a new format, and that's how I view it. It's a new format of Test cricket, just as, in a sense, T20 is a new format of short form cricket. Pink ball, day and night, is a new form of long form cricket, and that's how I think it should be recorded in history. Because I think the pink ball, the black side screen, the day night conditions are significantly different to traditional 4-day cricket.
So you think that it should not be.
It should be seen as a separate format.
A separate format.
So we now have, in my mind, we've now got four formats. We've got two long form. One's traditional Test cricket, one's pink ball Test cricket. And then we've got two short forms of the game, 1-day cricket, T20 cricket.
So how do you see the cricket moving from here to the next millennium?
I think cricket is in a really healthy position if it understands how to utilise the different products that it's got. So we talked earlier about off-field and on-field. So off-field consumerism of the game, I think, can now be satisfied in a whole range of different ways with four formats. And on-field, I think it gives greater opportunity to so many more people to be involved in cricket in whatever format they want to choose. And ideally, most players who play first-class cricket at higher levels would ideally like to be able to play as many of those formats as possible. So again, administrators have got to think very clearly and carefully how they mix all those together to enable that to occur. Otherwise, what they'll have to do is segment it so that as players are coming through, they may have to decide whether they're going to be short form player or a long form player.
At the same time, money is, I mean, taking a whole new perspective in cricket. I mean, becoming like a golf or football or.
Yes.
I mean, how do you see that?
Yes.
Recently, the Australians had a problem.
Yes, of course, of course. Look, I think it's an interesting issue that. If you're at the top of your game, or in the top of your sport, therefore you should be, remunerated accordingly. Whether there's any capping or benchmark level that should be set on that, that'll be determined by the marketplace. In other words, if we continue to play players more and more, then that's taking either money away from grassroots, critical nursery for any form of cricket anyway, or the consumers have to pay more. So they either pay more through the gate or they pay more through pay television or subscription models online. So whether the marketplace will want to sustain that, I'm not sure either. My view is that, and again, there's quite a deal of disparity, of course, in terms of what Australian players get paid, what Sri Lankan players get paid, what Bangladeshi players get paid. And then down through the ranks, Ireland, Afghanistan, wherever you want to go. So there is never a consistency there. But I think whatever a country can sustain, then I guess the international players, the players that sit at the top, should be remunerated accordingly for that. Who knows where that goes. I don't have a crystal ball on that one. Don't have a crystal ball on that. But all I would say is that I think the game has to be very concerned about the nursery, the grassroots, club cricket, and even prior to club cricket, it's around schools and so on. So that if we've got these four formats, we've got wonderful international players demonstrating how to play the game, that will only continue provided that the pathways to get there are well supported and well resourced. So it's about players, it's about facilities, it's about equipment, it's about coaching. If we don't look after that part, then irrespective of the number of formats and the amount of money, we won't have the right standard of players moving through the system.
Now, finally, if you get the opportunity Sri Lanka.
No, I wouldn't be involved. I mean, I finished in 2007. I finished in 2007 for a reason that I knew that I would not have the energy, the passion, and the motivation to coach a national side for any length of time. It's just too time consuming, and as a result, I couldn't do the job properly. However, what I would be interested in always is helping coaches. If hypothetically Sri Lanka said, well, we've got a bunch of new coaches that we'd really like to develop as our, it could be the women's coach, A teams, the national teams and so on. We've got a prospective bunch here. Would you be interested in mentor coaching, getting them to understand how they coach teams, players get the best out of teams? I'm interested in that. That's what my business is about. My business is about coaching leaders, coaching coaches. So I could help in that way, but certainly couldn't help as a full-time
coach. Yeah. Thank you, John. It's been a pleasure.
Pleasure. You too.